find out who is the real revolutionary. And I don't want my people to be tricked by mercenaries. Brother, you're right, you're right. It in a Zimbabwe, mash it up in a Zimbabwe, set it up in a Zimbabwe, Africans are liberate Zimbabwe, Africans are liberate Zimbabwe, not it do bit in a Zimbabwe,
set it up.
Hello, good morning.
Good morning, ma'am.
How are you, everyone?
We're blessed, thanks, and you?
I'm fine. Let me call house to order. Good morning, colleagues. Good morning. Yes,
good morning, Chair. Good morning.
Good morning, Chair. How are you, Chair Rashidi?
We're good, leader. We're good.
I'm fine. Thank you. I'll just put my video for a short while because I've got a very bad connection. Just to say hi, everyone. Allow me to switch off my video. Good morning.
Nice ceiling there, Chair.
Thank you.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, let me call house to order once again. My name is Evanice Munando. I am the vice chairperson of the Crisis in Zimbabwe Coalition. And it is my singular honor to be the one who is starting the meeting today. And thank you, Chair, for affording me that very important opportunity. May I kindly ask, I think it's Margaret, can you please mute your mic as we begin our meeting? Thank you.
What's your name? What's your username?
Hello? Please, the host, can you assist me in muting those who are chatting while our meeting is in progress? Thank you. Once again, good morning, colleagues. Let me welcome you to this meeting being organized by the Crisis in Zimbabwe Coalition, a coordinating body for the civil society organizations in Zimbabwe. We have arranged or organized such meeting to reflect on the journey that we have traveled as a nation 40 years after independence. It is quite a long time, yeah? And in this meeting, we have representatives from different sections or sectors who give their perspective on Zimbabwe's independence 41 years later. And amongst them, there are different organizations from different sectors, women, youth, that are going to also give their perspective. It is my hope and trust that we will fruitfully deliberate as we reflect and discuss the way forward. And as we are going to interrogate or reflect on the gains, challenges, gaps that we have noticed as a nation 41 years later after we attained our independence, I think this is an opportune time as we prepare to have our Independence Day very soon. And as we reflect today, it gives us an opportunity to really notice or identify those milestones that we've achieved as a nation across all sectors. That's why this meeting is very important, that we've gathered as a coalition to discuss these issues that concerns us as citizens of Zimbabwe. And it is a very good timing whilst we are still grappling with the COVID-19 pandemic. And as a question I would want to leave with you, is COVID-19 also impacted or derailed the gains that we've made during and after we had attained our independence? So it's a very interesting topic today that we are also going to touch on all those pertinent issues that affect us as citizens. And at the end of this meeting, we are going to map the way forward in terms of what we are going to do in our different sectors and in our different organizations, so that at least as we reach 50, we should celebrate the 50 Jubilee. I mean, looking back, and even in our grandson, you'd be able to tell that we've done much, or reflect on what we've done as their parents. So at this juncture, ladies and gentlemen, allow me to invite the chairperson of the Crisis in Zimbabwe Coalition, Mr. Rashid Mahia, who is going to take us through the objectives of this meeting and also introduce to us the keynote speaker to this meeting. Over to you, Mr. Rashid Mahia. Are you there? Yeah. Hello? Over to you, Chair. Thank you. I submit.
I'm trying to unmute. Thank you, Chair. Thanks, comrades. I will try and present my face so that whatever discussions we're going to have here, I will stand by them as part of as the leadership of the coalition. So thank you, Vice Chair, for the introductions. Thank you for the clarity in terms of what we seek to do. Welcome, colleagues and comrades, to the Crisis and Global Coalition platform, where we seek to have a conversation on the Zimbabwe at 41, trying to unpack a progressive approach towards a nation state. We meet today 41 years later. I'm convinced that some of the comrades that are on this platform were not even born when Zimbabwe celebrated, when Zimbabwe got its independence in 1980. And it's important for us as civil society, as citizens, to have this conversation. Objectively so, about where we are 41 years later. We'll celebrate the achievements, objectively so, but also interrogate the weaknesses and the challenges that have put us and taken us to a situation where we are now. We've got high levels of unemployment. We've got a highly polarized nation. We have a highly tribalized nation, and I'm more than privileged to be part of this conversation, an important conversation. I'm also more than privileged to welcome comrades that have been part of the coalition and the struggle for a long time, I see Dr. Zams in the gallery. I see a lot of many other comrades that have been part of the coalition platform that have sought to put the state to account, hold it to account. So there has been an accusation against civil society and against citizens of being pro-West and being watchdogs of foreign interests. So today, as we hold this platform, we are proud to be Zimbabweans. We're also proud that we, even though we were not in the trenches and fighting, that we fought and that there was independence, but we are going to question the post-independent era. That while people can celebrate that there was an increase in the number of schools that were built post-independence, the people of Matabeleland cannot celebrate the increase in the number of schools, because during that period, there was a Gukurahundi that was killing innocent civilians. And even now, as you speak, the infrastructure that they have does not reflect a period of independence. While we try to celebrate the fact that we were a breadbasket of this country, or of Africa and the world, we can't speak of that today in a free Zimbabwe. But again, how do we interrogate the fact that the majority of our people, even though a majority of them belong to the ruling party or are partisan, have learned? So the Crisis Model Coalition will provide you a platform where we're going to have this conversation. A very objective conversation on Zimbabwe at 41. So we stand here proud of the flag, but appreciative of the fact that there are some citizens and the majority of them that are not proud of the flag, because the flag reminds them of the horror, flag reminds them of the victimization of ordinary citizens. We should be proud of all the institutions of the state that we say have brought unity, or that have brought peace or independence to our country. But the majority of our citizens are crying because of Gukurahundi in the early 80s, because of Murambatrina, because of 2008, and the consistent victimization of the state, or of the citizens by the state. So we sit here in this platform on this day to reflect, cognizant of these realities, appreciative of the fact that we as the citizens of this country have a responsibility to organize and celebrate outside the state, but also to hold the state to account. So I have a singular honor in this, on this platform, to start this conversation, to welcome Professor Sabelo Ndlovu Gatsheni, who was not a stranger to Zimbabwe. He's a Zimbabwean, he's an academic, but also he's written immensely on Zimbabwe, on the issues around the state and nationhood. And we are proud, as the Crisis Model Coalition, to have this conversation on the eve of the independence celebrations. While we wanted to go to the stadiums to celebrate and watch Highlanders play dynamos, we think there's more to independence than just these ceremonies. So I welcome Professor Ndlovu, who's currently working as full professor and chair in epistemologies of the Global South with emphasis on Africa at the University of Bayreuth in Germany. He has previously worked as a research professor and director in the Department of Leadership and Transformation in the Principal and Vice Chancellor's Office at the University of South Africa, that's UNISAF. Prior to this, Professor Ndlovu has worked as executive director of the Change Management Unit in the Principal and Vice Chancellor's Office at the University of South Africa. Professor Ndlovu has worked as founding head of the Achimafeje Research Institute for Applied Social Policy and full professor in the Department of Development Studies at the University of South Africa. He was a Bachelor of Arts Honours degree in History, an MA in African History, a DPhil in Historical Studies in University of Zimbabwe, a postgraduate diploma in tertiary teaching from the University of the Wits, and a certificate in research supervision from Monash University. So we are proud to have Professor Gatsheni here to be the keynote address, to provide the keynote address. I think many of you have interacted with his publications, and you cannot label Professor Gatsheni the watchdog of foreign interests in imperialism. So it is in my singular honor for me to announce and allow Professor Gatsheni to provide us with, to present to us the keynote address. Professor Gatsheni, thank you for gracing us. And
thank you.
I leave this to you. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Rashid, for the generous introduction, and thanks, Evanice, for starting us. I hope everyone can hear me. Despite the fact that Rashid presented my academic credentials, I think an occasion like this one, I don't think we need those. I think what we need at this moment is for me to speak as a concerned citizen rather than an academic. And I think that will enable me to touch on the practical issues facing us as a people. And I think also that approach will also make me move away from the books and the theories to really talk about very practical issues which are troubling us as a nation. And indeed, it is an honor to be invited to lead this dialogue on Zimbabwe at 41. And I think there are two contextual issues here which I need to highlight. The first one, of course, is the maturity of our country reaching 41. And the second is really the debates which are crystallizing around the patriotic bill, which I think also speaks to the journey we have traveled as a people. And indeed, the Independence Day is coming on the 18th of April this year. And indeed, it is an opportunity to honor those who sacrificed for the attainment of political independence. But at the same time, we need to use this moment every year to reflect on the journey we have traveled since 1980 as a people. And this actually raises a number of issues which I will flag straight away from this beginning. The first issue being the issue of the very meaning of being independent and being free. To what use have we made of this independence? I think that's an important question for us to reflect today. And secondly, I think it is important also to raise the question, the pertinent question of how have we created Zimbabwe, and what type of a Zimbabwe have we created? That actually speaks to other pertinent issues, which is our issues of belonging, citizenship, unity, patriotism, dignity, pride, and heroism. And indeed, as we reflect on those issues, we need also to reflect on some of the material issues. How have we distributed our national resources, and who has benefited from them, and who has not? The issues also speak to our governance. How have we governed ourselves, and how have we made sure that as a people we enjoy justice, we enjoy rights, and we are protected from violence and from death itself? I think these are also important issues which relate also, how have we made sure that our country moves forward beyond the issues of patriarchy, issues of sexism. And indeed, having gained independence, what milestones have we done in terms of infrastructure and the development? And indeed, Rashid spoke about the milestones which we achieved in health, in education in the 1980s at the same time, while there were problems and indeed a genocide taking place in Matabeleland and the Midlands. And indeed, we need to be honest and reflect on this critically. And I think it is also speaks to another important aspect of our reflections today, which is the issue of internal security and the social peace. Have we enjoyed internal security and the social peace since we attained independence in 1980? And already Rashid spoke about the institutions, the state institutions, and we need also to reflect on the state institutions, their effectiveness, their abuse and the use, or otherwise. And finally, I want to also raise an important aspect which we need to reflect on today, which is the issue of leadership in this country, in our country, in our beloved Zimbabwe. How have we been choosing our leaders? Have we been following the rule of law? Have we been following constitutionalism? And these are important questions, which some think when you raise them, therefore you are an enemy of Zimbabwe. But as far as I'm concerned, we raise these questions because we are concerned patriotic citizens. These are questions which are actually at the center and they must actually preoccupy all of us as Zimbabweans, as concerned people. We must therefore pose them without fear and favor. If we indeed, the word patriotism means something, because they are about us and our country, and they constitute what amounts to a national question, a question which is always at the heart of the nation building project, the very making, creation, and the construction of Zimbabwe. They always take us back to the drawing board to assess our achievements and the failures. And when I spoke to Itai Zimunya, and he shared with me the concept note, it had an interesting title, "Does Zimbabwe Exist?" And I think also we must approach this question not as a question of rejecting Zimbabwe, but as a question, as a patriotic question that arises out of a particular context. And it is a question which I also raised myself in 2009 in my book, "Do Zimbabweans Exist? Trajectories of Nationalism, National Identity Formation, and the Crisis in Zimbabwe." And it is a question which has preoccupied other concerned Zimbabweans, such as Brian Raptopoulos and Alois Mlambo in their book, "Becoming Zimbabwe, A History from Pre-Colonial Times to 2008. And earlier on, it preoccupied even scholars like Ibo Mandaza in his book, "Zimbabwe, A Political Economy of Transition," where he raised the questions of state making and the nation building. And they were raising these questions, and they are not arising out of a vacuum, they are arising out of a context. And that context needs to be taken seriously because it has implications of how we understand state making and the nation building. And I must say that there are some people who have a mistaken notion that you can just name the place between the Zambezi River and in the north and the Limpopo River in the south, you name it Zimbabwe, therefore it becomes Zimbabwe. It doesn't work as easy as that. There are some who also have mistaken notions that taking over the Rhodesian state is not the same as creating Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe has never been a given. And I must repeat, Zimbabwe has never been a given. Zimbabwe has never been a pre-existing formation. As a unitary nation state, Zimbabwe had to be created. It is not a successor state. Because if we say it is a successor state, it will be problematic. It is a successor to which state? Because the land between the Zambezi and the Limpopo River saw the emergence of the Dora state, the Rose state, the Mtapa state, Barwe state, the Manyika state, the Ndebele state, the Gaza. So if it is a successor, it is a successor to which one? So I will think it will be problematic to think about it there like that. Let's think about it. Zimbabwe is a product of our own imagination of freedom and liberation. And because of that, we must consistently build it. It's a construction which actually comes from our own efforts. And we need to invest consistently in making sure that it becomes a reality. And it becomes a reality which makes all of us live comfortably. I'm raising this not because I'm a historian, but I'm raising this so that when we open up for discussions, I've touched almost all of the issues which I think are important. Of course, by saying Zimbabwe is our creation, I'm not saying that the lands between the Zambezi and the Limpopo rivers had no people before Zimbabwe was born. There were people between in those land, and the people were African. They were African people, but they were African people of diverse identities. Of course, that history, that heritage, we cannot minimize its importance in enabling us to construct our nationalism. We drew from that diverse histories in the construction of nationalism. For example, we actually took the name of the country from the Great Zimbabwe Heritage Site. And that actually also means that when we speak about Zimbabwe, we are talking about a diverse people, but the diversity does not mean the people are not one. We are diverse, but we are actually one people. We are the people of Zimbabwe. And if I can go on speaking about us creating Zimbabwe, we can go on to many foundational events which actually brought us together to think about a common home called Zimbabwe. The first being the primary resistance of 1896 and 1897, which provided us with a myth of foundation of African unity for a national purpose. The liberation struggle, as we all know, through not only from the inspiration of the uprising, but also examples of heroes and heroines from that struggle. But I must hasten to say, our major problem is whenever we draw from our pre-colonial history, whenever we draw from the primary resistance, we always do it very selectively. We highlight, we select some heroes and ignore some. And that actually then creates a problem in terms of belonging and the others thinking that their history, their heroes are actually marginalized or actually ignored. And I think as we celebrate 41 years of independence, we need to think seriously about how we use symbols, how we use statues, how we select heroes, so that next time we are more careful to the extent that we take into account that we are diverse people and the heroes, our heroes are also diverse. The second important historical part of us understanding ourselves is, of course, the colonial experience. I must hasten to say, colonialism never created Zimbabwe. In fact, the concept of a nation, of black people constituting a nation, was anathema to colonialism. Colonialism wanted to see us as tribes, as contending tribes, as inchoate tribes who were actually at each other's throat. And that notion sometimes is repeated ad infinitum by some of us as a part and a parcel of rejecting the whole issue of being Zimbabwean, because that colonial history sometimes is taken as a gospel truth. So what was in the minds of the colonialists was actually to divide and rule. And even those who began to speak about who began to develop the consciousness of Zimbabwean. We know from the historical record that it is those people who were detained for years and years for thinking that way, because colonialism never wanted us to actually coalesce into a nation, into one people with a common consciousness. But colonialism also contributed inadvertently to the nationalism in the sense that by exploiting us as a group, by exploiting us as a people of a similar color, we developed really a sentiment of being one people. And by drawing the boundaries, of course, they also contributed. And by providing modern education, they produced the educated elite who actually led the struggles for national independence. And then the third important event or process, I will not call it an event, is African nationalism and the imagination of Zimbabwe. And I must say and repeat the theme which is cutting across what I'm sharing with you today, the issue of we are creating Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe is never a pre-existing. Even Zimbabwean nationalism had to be created. It did not pre-exist. And the history, symbols, and the grievances became important resources for the nationalists in their creation of Zimbabwe. And you remember the early nationalists putting on the skinheads on top of the suits, which actually showed that there was tension between drawing from our cultural heritage, but at the same time also drawing from modernist repertoires of modernity as they created nationalism. And we actually pay tribute to them for leading to the formation of mass nationalist movement, the NDP, ZAPU, ZANU, and the others. And they also, we pay tribute to them for creating hope in us that when we come together as a nation, when we defeat colonialism, the hope was that we're going to be better people. We're going to live in a better country. And the nationalists, they actually deployed persuasive ideology to mobilize the population into being Zimbabweans. And they are actually supposed to be given credit for actually coming up with that type of mobilization. And one of the issues which we, as we reflect on nationalism, is also to say during that very time of mass mobilization, the ugly head of violence began to emerge. The idea of monolithic unity began to actually lead to intolerances of any diverging ideas. And even not only with specific as a reference to Zimbabwe, but to specific reference to post-colonial Africa, the leftist nationalists, they were always very suspicious of the role of tribalism in the process of nation making. And you remember Samora Machel is widely quoted as having coined this idea that for the nation to live, the tribe must die. But what we must reflect critically, how do you kill a tribe without killing a people? I think that's an important idea we need to think about. And we must also not romanticize the edge of the nationalism, because among nationalists, ethnicity wreaked havoc and caused division and splits. We had to go into the armed liberation struggle without satisfactory resolution of ethnic divisions. And that must be put forward clearly like that. But I must say that because we were making ourselves into a nation, and they were also making a nation which was supposed to come out of the end of colonialism, the armed nationalist liberation struggle was supposed to be a continuation from mass mobilization, and fundamentally a school to raise the consciousness of the people about self-governance, self-determination. And indeed, from the mass nationalist mobilization, we entered into guerrillas who were continued from the mass nationalists in the mobilization of the people for a nation called Zimbabwe. And therefore, the phase of the armed liberation struggle is an important one as a base from which the nation and the state had to be built. And in terms of the positive aspect, nationalism, of course, successfully made it possible for the armed liberation struggle. And the armed liberation struggle we expected it to actually result concretely in the birth of Zimbabwe. But they were always hovering global imperial designs consisting of the British, who were still responsible for Rhodesia. And there were also other important considerations, particularly from the global colonial imperial designs. What do we do with the minority white members of Rhodesia independence when independence comes? And also we have apartheid and the apartheid South Africa, as well as the Americans concerned about the possibility of Zimbabwe being turned red. In other words, being taken over by what they called the communists. And they were all comfortable with Zimbabwe being born as a neo-colony rather than an independent socialist republic. And this takes us to another important event as we take stock of where we come from, and that is the negotiated nature of the idea of Zimbabwe, the idea negotiated at Lancaster House, and the restrictions which emerged as a result of that, a restrictive constitution, the protection of material privileges of the white minority settlers, and the unresolved land question. One can also add that there was also unresolved ethnic question and a no clear nation state building blueprint. Therefore, despite all the excitement, Zimbabwe was born with a very bad birthmark. And I must also add that when the nationalists came back from Zambia, from Mozambique in 1980, they did not come back as a united front. They did not come back as what we expected, the patriotic front. They came back fragmented, and the consequences, we will see them very soon. And I want also to flag something which we can debate during the discussions. And this is the issue of the lack of a blueprint for the nation which we wanted to create. In South Africa, they have the Freedom Charter of 1955, which speak about South Africa, all people belonging to it, speak about a non-racial South Africa, speaking about a democratic South Africa. When I checked our record, of course, we have this Kombela Declaration and the Mukakawe Declarations, but they have nothing to do with nation building. It is more about power, questions of power, not national questions. And in our desperate search for a guiding document, we therefore tended to run to the independence reconciliation speech of Prime Minister Robert Gabriel Mugabe in 1980 as part of an example of nation building. But it was largely targeted. It was largely targeted at the white minority, and its scope was thus very limited. And we also speak about the coalition government from 1980 to 1982. Again, some mistake it to be a unit government. It was never a unit government. It was a coalition government. And throughout its brief existence, ZANU-PF conducted itself as though Zimbabwe was already a one-party state. PF ZAPU, ZIPRA were consistently belittled, provoked, and its liberation credentials downplayed. And the other opportunity which we missed during that early period was the integration of the armed forces into the Zimbabwe National Army. I think that was going to be an important lever also of nation building if we handled it with care. And this takes us to one of the most negative aspects of our nation, which is the Operation Kukurawundi from 1983 to 1987. This was a time, in my estimation, when the mask of nationalism fell off and the unresolved ethnic ghost marched naked across the nation, resulting in the open and brazen attack by the 5th Brigade on civilians and the death of thousands. This was the first moment, as far as I'm concerned, signifying the lack of commitment to nation building and the overinvestment in consolidation of partisan political power at the expense of the nation. We had emerged in the 1960s with the popular nationalism and the wish and even the expectation was to translate that popular anti-colonial nationalism into what I will call post-colonial horizontal pan-ethnic patriotic comradeship. But I don't think we actually succeeded in doing that. The question of being patriotic, therefore, emerges during the time of Operation Kukurawundi in its most problematic renditions. Belonging to the ruling party became a marker of being patriotic. Having a ZANU-PF card became a marker of being patriotic. Not belonging to the opposition became a marker of being patriotic. Sometimes even speaking a particular language became a sign of being patriotic. And this image is clearly from the way the people of Matabeleland and the Midland regions were forced to take party cards, to sing party songs, to recite party slogans. And I think from that, I must say we have a patriotic duty to speak in all our languages without one language being forced on others. And our new constitution, I think it has 16, if not 14 languages. And we need to actually, as a matter of patriotic duty, be able to speak some of them. I'm continuing now towards the end of my reflections, but I think I must say that Operation Kukurawundi can simply not be dismissed as a moment of madness. It was more than that. Our problematic nationalism with its haunting ethnic subtext hit its lowest ebb during that time. And I want to continue by saying from 1987, from my own estimation, we tended to intensify pursuit of power and a less concern about nation building. And I don't want to waste your time by speaking about the UNITA Accord. We all know it was a conquest of ZAPU and its incorporation into the ruling party for purposes of one party state. You can also reflect about what was the role of the Global Political Agreement of 2008. You can also reflect on what has been the contribution of Operation Restore Lagos of November 2017. But what I want to end with the two, if not three points. The first one is that, as I said, that we must take the issue of Zimbabwe as an ongoing construction by us. And this fundamentally means, therefore, the hope lies with progressive forces. And these consist of intellectuals, of students, of youth, of workers, of women, formations, of legal formations, of church formations, of civil society formations, and indeed, progressive politicians. This hope is not based on nothing. It is based on the fact that from the 1990s onwards, such formations as the NCA, such formations as the ZCTU, such formations as the MDC, they actually tried to push for reconstitution of the political through a people-driven constitution. And the 2013 constitution is a product of those efforts. And I must say that without a new constitution, the political cannot be reconstituted. So therefore, we have to make sure that the 2013 constitution is alive and made the basis of our political conduct. But I want to go back, not because I come from Matabeleland, to go back to say, when we think about nation rebuilding, I think we need to go back to the issue of Kukurawundi. And I will try to speak slowly here so that people understand and that they don't misquote me. I want to argue that the open veins of Kukurawundi problem offers us a key rallying point to bring the nation building project back on the agenda as part of rebuilding a Zimbabwe that we all want. By making it a material problem, we are giving the perpetrators an escape route from accountability and minimizing its foundational negative consequences for governance and the nation. We cannot be spectators once again, if not complicit once more, on an issue which has now engulfed the entire nation. And I want to continue to say, if we think deeply about what happened between 1983 and 1987, we will see that the nation actually died in Matabeleland and the Mikkelands. And I want to argue that what Professor Martin Rubia termed governance by military operations started with Operation Kukurawundi. And it is today into Operation Mrambatswina and the other operations. Massive rape of women as a political tool and a punishment started during Operation Kukurawundi. Denying people food because of political affiliation started with Operation Kukurawundi. Arrests and the detentions of political opponents in manufactured churches began during Operation Kukurawundi. Deployment of the army against citizens began during Operation Kukurawundi. Open writing of a section of a Zimbabwean population out of the nation and beyond the protection of law began with Operation Kukurawundi. The notion that patriotism can be forced through violence and a prosecution began during Operation Kukurawundi. Switching off media so as to commit atrocities began with Operation Kukurawundi. Abductions and the disappearance of people happened during Kukurawundi. And if we resolved all that, you can see that we can begin to resolve some of the major problems which we're facing as a people today. And I want to conclude by saying, where the nation building project has been abandoned, there is no nationalism and patriotism. This is because it is those in leadership that must embody and exhibit patriotism through love for the people. The first essential prerequisite for cultivation of patriotism as a child of nationalism is to respect and protect the life of the people through the state. A state which terrorizes the nation cannot expect, let alone cultivate, patriotism. It is this type of states which end up conjuring up ideas. conjuring the idea of generating patriotism through legal means of prosecution and punishment. When such an idea crosses the minds of the ruling elite, and when such a moment visits the people, the nation state building project would have failed. The notion of trying to enforce patriotism through law only arises within a context of dismal failure to deliver service to the people. Service delivery and the protection offered by the state to its own citizens automatically generates love for the state from the people. Belonging to a particular state which generates embarrassment through its failures undercuts patriotism. And I must end by saying, as far as I know, Zimbabweans are the most patriotic people. Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you, Professor Gatsheni. I think if we're going to have people clapping, it was a very open and live process. We have a conversation. We are provoked, and I take your conclusion. Where the nation building project has been abandoned, there's no recourse through forced patriotism. Zimbabwe was not a pre-existing nation state. We have to make Zimbabwe. That has been a pursuit of power versus nation building. Emphasis on power and control. That Kukurawundi epitomizes the stage and the point at which the nation died because Gugraundi is the point at which the military was deployed against innocent citizens. That patriotism was being forced on citizens. That media was being closed on the basis of disagreements and the figures that was taking place. You raise important issues that which I might not be able to capture here, and many important issues that I think colleagues and comrades that are here have captured. The overriding factor is that Zimbabwe is not a pre-existing state, that we have to make Zimbabwe, we have to contribute towards Zimbabwe, that we have a responsibility through ensuring that the 2013 constitution is alive, because it is the basis and the center upon which we can build this nation called Zimbabwe. That takes time, it takes effort for us to build this country called Zimbabwe. We can't force patriotism. We can't legislate patriotism. And in your conclusion, Zimbabweans are the most patriotic that you know, even after having gone through this much. And you've given us the history of Zimbabwe, the nation, the state. So I will take this time to appreciate your contribution, Professor Gatsheni. Thought-provoking. I think a lot of people and comrades here concur and agree with you, but they've got a number of questions that they want to ask. But I'm told by comrades that are running this program behind the scenes that we need a short break as people digest your contribution, your presentation, so that they come up with a very clear questions and contributions. So okay. I'll leave it to the comrades that are running the program to give us the break as people digest, process, so that we've got a very interesting and solid conversation about Zimbabwe at 41, a nation that did not exist before, that we have to make. Thank you, comrades. I leave it to the comrades that are running the issue.
Smile with the rising sun. Three little birds. It's by my door.
thank you. Thank you, comrades. Thank you, colleagues. Thank you for Professor Gatsheni for your presentation. Before we go to the other comrades that are to ask questions, we have a, how do you kill it? How do you kill the tribe without killing the people? I think it's a very honest and genuine question. How do you kill the tribe? If you're going to quote Samora Machel, without killing the tribe, was in Zimbabwe, if Samora Machel's statement was anything to go by, the killing of the tribe then translated to killing of the people. It's a question that we contend with. And I think Tamuka, in his address, in his presentation, will try to answer that question and many other questions that comrades and colleagues here are asking. Tamuka is going to give us a note on redefining the nature of a nation state. Comrade Tamuka, what is the nature of a nation state? Taking on from what Professor Gatsheni has provided to us and presented to us. Let's have this conversation. Comrade Tamuka, it's your turn. Please take it on.
Thank you very much, Chairman Rashidi. And it's an honor and privilege to speak after legends have actually paved the way. You know, I've always find the Prof's ideas very illuminating and mind-blowing. And when you listen to his presentation, I think he has managed to problematize the Zimbabwean question and actually brought it to the whole issue. And if listening to his presentation, it centered around the issue of nation building and looking at Zimbabwe as a nation to say, where have we missed it? Where have been the opportunities or the missing points? Where could we have got things right? And I think I agree entirely with his diagnosis because I concur quite a lot. I'm not going to spend much more time, but I'm going to re-emphasize certain points which I found very illuminating from his presentations, and also try to poke a bit into history, looking at what civil society has done, and also saying going forward, what could be the imperatives? Because frankly speaking, we need a nation. We need a nation, whether we'll call it Zimbabwe or we'll call it by any other name. What is quite clear is that we don't have a nation. Because even if you listen to the conversations that have been going on in Zimbabwe, particularly within the past, the past few months or years going back, the issue of who is a Zimbabwean has always been at the center of the stage. Say, who is a Zimbabwean? Whereby you have got who is a Zimbabwean being the preserve of a certain people who can define who is a Zimbabwean and who is not, and what is patriotic enough. But then if we are to ask ourselves, who is a Zimbabwean? What does it mean to be Zimbabwean? And I think he gave us something which is quite good, the 2013 Constitution. It could be a starting point of which we can build around. Because when you look at the 2013 Constitution, it was a product which came through many struggles that came with the constitutional movement, when around the NCA, where the Zimbabwean issue was trying to be framed around the constitutional issue. To say, okay, for us to create what is Zimbabwe, we need that sovereign, the sovereign will which we all submit ourselves to. And I think the 2013 Constitution speaks to that. And when we now begin to reflect and even look what has been happening, particularly after the so-called new dispensation came in, you already have mutilation of that constitution, where already before its full implementation, that constitution is being mutilated and being changed to suit certain notions. And I think he actually couched it quite well when he talked about Mugagao, during the liberation struggle, when he analyzed, he said, When you look at Mngagawa in comparison to the Freedom Charter, which existed in South Africa, Mngagawa was more about the pursuit of power for the sake of power. Yet, whereas you look at the Freedom Charter, it emphasizes those who live in South Africa, I mean, to all people. It speaks about building a nation. So even when you come, the prognosis, when he looks at the after independence, say, the best you can look at is the Prime Minister's speech of 90. But when you look at it, it had limitations where it focused on accommodating the white minority, not actually accommodating, but assuaging the interests of capital and white minority and pleasing the Western world. Not necessarily resolving the differences that had emerged or the issues that were in the liberation movement. So when the Patriotic Front came back, it was not necessary, it was a Patriotic Front on paper. It was not united. There were issues, lingering questions which were unresolved, lingering ethnic questions which were unresolved. So when you look at these things, we didn't pay attention to that. The euphoria came in. And then this is why we saw what happened in Matabele, the Midlands province in the 80s, the issues of Gukurahundi and the genocide. And even when you look, the interventions which are there currently, they are not about owning up or resolving these issues, even when you look at the from the side of the executive. It's about trying to evade responsibility by attempting to buy a few people or so and telling people to be silent, but not to heal people and create one nation. So having said this, what it simply means we've got an unfinished business of nation building. And I think the prof characterized it quite well when he spoke about, he characterized quite well when he spoke about Zimbabwe. To say, even if you go into, you want to go into history, I know the current government loves so much to quote history. If you look to say Zimbabwe, if you say it's a successor to which state, you won't be able to locate it. But what you see that Zimbabwe is a creation, was an imagination of the liberation efforts of the people within of Zimbabwe. And this imagination and creation has not yet been finalized. If this thing had been resolved, at the moment, we would not be speaking about Gukurahundi. We would not be speaking about revolutionaries and sellouts in Zimbabwe. We would not be talking about having the Patriot Bill. We would not be talking about why someone should have land or someone should not have, whether people in the opposition deserve land or not. It would not be a problem for a person to belong to an opposition party if we had resolved the issues of nation building. We would not have political motivated killings or political motivated rapings. We would not have political motivated abductions. We would not have the jailing of human rights defenders. But like the prof correctly pointed it out, we missed an opportunity. And that opportunity was during Gukurahundi. Because when we see these things happening today, if you are to go back into history, you will see a clear rubric and a clear template and a trajectory of where this is going. But I think when it was happening by then, for a lot of people, it was not much of a concern because we're saying, Comrade Itai say, what the prof acknowledged about Comrade Itai when he spoke about progress, the so-called progress, and I'll say progress in quotation marks, the building of schools and clinics and a number of development indicators. But what we didn't pay attention to amid this so-called positive development trajectory, there were coffins and bodies, mothers and children being denied food, being raped, being killed. People who were being denied the right to exist, being denied humanity. On the basis of a language and political difference. So even when you see what happens, if you are to take the 1987 Unity Accord and then later on the 2008 GNU, these were much more about power consolidation rather than to say want to right the wrongs. Because if these were about true unity and building a nation, we would not be still having the same challenges which we are having. So I would say this is I would say this is what came out and it from the Prof's presentation. So, but one key challenge which he has given us, and I think which should actually inform us going forward, is that we should take the issue of Zimbabwe as a concept that needs to be taken to its logical conclusion. It's something which has not yet been finalized. And it's not something which can be brought through legislation like through the Patriot Bill or because somebody is sitting within the ruling party or somebody's in government. It's not something which is bestowed to us by the president or by a minister, by a member of a parliament. But the moment that Zimbabwean, you live within Zimbabwe. So I think maybe we need to borrow from the South African Freedom Charter to say Zimbabwe belongs to all who live in it. And if we are to go into our history, we have got, I know civil society have made the efforts and the crisis coalition has been part of it. This, if you look at the Zimbabwe People's Charter, there have been efforts toward that. And then of course the Save Zimbabwe campaign, I mean coalition, which crisis coalition actually was very instrumental in its birthing. So when you look at even these things of citizens' convergence, when it came and we had even the document beyond. So we need to craft, I think what the professor has given us is a call, is a homework and a call to duty to say we need to challenge the powers that be or those who feel that they are more Zimbabwean than others or they have the right to craft what is a Zimbabwean. So that we constantly create, and I think this will be, this is one of the key purposes of progressive civil society, to set the agenda and charge. So we need to create a nation. The question which you were saying to say, which you posed Chairman Rashid on tribes, and I know the late President Samora Machel actually raised this, to say we don't need tribes. And I think the professor also characterized that the colonialism did not want a nation, a black nation in Zimbabwe. What it wanted were tribes, just like they wanted Bantustans in South Africa. And if you see, this is something which we also need to do to work around.
You're rounding up.
Yes, I'm actually rounding off, Mr. Chair. So I was just responding to your question on tribes. Because certainly, if you look at the debates in Zimbabwe, we don't need tribes. But for tribes, for the tribe to die, the people don't need to die. We can have different languages, but one people. Just as Comrade Laki Dube said, different colors, one people, you know? So I'll say for Zimbabwe, different colors, different languages, one people. Whether they're Ndebele, Ndau, Shong, Zezuru, Tonga, Nambia, at the end of the day, we all belong to humanity and Zimbabwe belongs to all who live in it. And as the Prof said, it is our duty to create and imagine this Zimbabwe. It doesn't stop with the liberation struggle or those who went to the war of the liberation in the 60s, 70s. We need to take this struggle forward and aluta continua. Thank you.
Thank you, Governor Tamuka. You further reinforce the position that has been clearly articulated by Professor Gatsheni. You reinforce the importance of building a nation. You also reinforce the importance of the distribution of national resources. You also reinforce the importance of the governance structure, and that we need to pay particular attention to how the nation is governed as part of building the nation state. The importance of internal security for social peace. And you emphasize the major point that has been raised by the professor, that
Zimbabwe did not exist pre-1980. It's not a pre-existing state. And if we talk of Zimbabwe, we need to work towards building Zimbabwe and ensuring that the nation state Zimbabwe is strengthened. You emphasize the importance of building solidarity and building collaborations and coalitions around holding the state to account and the progressive citizens coming together in holding the state to account and ensuring that we do not have a one-party state, which Professor Gatsheni emphasized that there was emphasis and important by the ruling elites during in 1980 to point and emphasize and reinforce the need for a one-party state. Thank you, Tamuka. Thank you for your points. Comrades have been noting and taking down the issues that you raised. And I think we're going to have a very fruitful conversation from your presentation that reinforces Professor Gatsheni's points and you further elaborate them, but also from the presentation that's going to come from Comrade Zenzele. Comrade Zenzele, there is a lot of emphasis here on the state that never existed that we need to build. I'm trying to understand from your end, speaking, there was a lot of emphasis on Gukurahundi. You've been doing a lot of documentation on Gukurahundi and dealing with the past around transitional justice, issues that we need to deal with in Zimbabwe. How do we deal with this? What is this perspective from Tibetan, but also your appreciation of the need and what we have to do to build the nation called Zimbabwe? Comrade Zenzele, if you are here, may you please take over and have this conversation with us. Thank you, Comrade Zenzele. Is Zenzele in here? Okay, so I get a note from here that okay, Zenzele is not part of the speakers, but might be part of the audience and will bring in a part of the conversation. But the questions that I've raised to Comrade Zenzele will apply to one of our speakers, major speakers, Sam Keliso, Kumalo, a comrade. Comrade Sam, may you please come in and answer some of the questions that I've raised, but also from a women perspective, a gender perspective. How do we build a nation called Zimbabwe? Do we have to build it? Is it necessary for us to do it? 41 years later, we need to have these questions. Samu, may you please come in? Thank you. Is Samu in there? It seems like Samu might not be anywhere close. Sam Kelito, are you in? Okay, whilst we have this conversation and we wait for Samu to come in, I hereby call upon Comrade Deoma Vinga to unpack the diaspora voices in Zimbabwe's independence. Comrade Deoma, Advocate Deoma, I'll call you Bishop Deoma.
Can you please come in? I think someone will come in later on. Bishop Advocate, Comrade, can you please come in? What's the role of the diaspora voices in Zimbabwe's independence? Thank you. Comrade Dewa is not here. Hello? Where are the people? Are they, have they gone for Independence Day celebrations? I can't locate Comrade Dewa. He doesn't seem to be here. I'll ask Dr. Zams. Dr. Zams, any reflections from the presentations that I've made so that you can we can have a conversation on the issues that have been raised around Zimbabwe at 41? Comrade Dr. Zams, are you still here?
Chairperson, I'm here. I didn't know that I was expected to contribute anything, but let me say that we had the most illuminating contributions from Chirimamboa and Sabelo. I don't think I would like to add much, but to pose an area for further discussion, especially to Prof Sabelo and Chirimamboa. This regime does use violence, I agree. But there is a tendency by the ideologues within the regime to justify this use of violence through some ideological patriotic rhetoric. And it's not just about the ruling elites. But if you also look at certain scholars, which you didn't touch on. So if we look at Yeros, if we look at Sam Moyo and Yeros as well, they would argue that what is actually happening in terms of violence in Zimbabwe is that it is endemic and is not gonna be extinguished in any permanent way, unless the neocolonial itself is, neocolonial state itself is defeated. That all this kind of violence, especially related to the land issue, was actually a triumph, the greatest challenge against neocolonialism since the end of the Cold War. So it will be interesting to hear your perspectives there. It's interesting that you did quote Mulambo and Raftoplas, but perhaps we should also deal with that aspect so that we are able to engage the ideologues within ZANU-PF. And lastly, I would like to hear more views about the role of the region and the international community, especially the West, in terms of Zimbabwe's efforts to build an enduring nation state. So thank you, Chair. I think if we can elaborate on those two areas, it might help further the debate.
Thank you, Dr. Zams, for just coming in. We know we can call on you even before we have engaged with you. And thank you for addressing the debate and the conversation. And I think Dr. Sabelo and Tamuka and other comrades that are going to make presentations have taken note of the questions that Dr. Zams raised around how the more views on the role of the region, one, and how do we deal with the ideological. So we raise those questions that have been raised as we take note, Professor
Gatsheni and other comrades that are going to make presentations. Thank you for Dr. Zams. And comrades, please do take note of the issues that are being raised, have been raised by Dr. Zams, but also are being raised in the question, in the chat box. Mayor Manyenyeni, you also, we take note of your presence and we think you've got questions and some answers. We've seen in you on a number of platforms where you raise a lot of issues from being, of course, internal within the progressive movement, but also having had the opportunity to interact with the state as the mayor of the capital city of Zimbabwe. So we take note of that, and as comrades, put your questions in the chat box so that we have an enlightened conversation going forward. I ask the president of the Zimbabwe Students Union, Zimbabwe National Students Union, Zinasu, Takuzo, I call him Comrade Takuzo, Comrade Taku, the student's perspective on Zimbabwe's independence. What do students say about Zimbabwe's independence? No scholarships. Students are dying and being exploited in universities. The right to academic freedoms has been denied. Taguzwa has spent more days in prison than in the lecture room. What are the perspectives of the students on the independence that we celebrate today? Comrade Taku, I pass this on to you, if you are there. Is the president not here? I assume the president is not here. I'll call him the president, who's not here. I think he's going to come and join us later. I then ask Comrade Sheila to come in. Comrade Sheila, can you please come in and please make your presentation and answer the questions that we ask. Comrade Sheila, it's your turn. Please do come in. It seems like people are not here. What's going on? People are going for independence celebrations. Bishop Magaya, are you in the auditorium? From the church perspective, 41 years after independence, Bishop Magaya,
yes. Can you please come? Yes. Please, okay, thank you Bishop very much. Magaya. Okay, thank you very much, Rashid. Special recognition to Professor Gatsheni for such mind-blowing and quite insightful presentation. Reflections on 41 years of independence, church's perspective. Ladies and gentlemen, it would not be an incorrect statement to say that the past 41 years of our independence have more of heartrending experiences than joyous moments, as has already been noted. Looking back through the memory lane, it becomes abundantly clear that there are indelible scars born out of the state-induced inflictions upon the citizens. Remember the Matabeleland massacres, which I wouldn't want to call Bukura Wundi, because as you know, Bukura Wundi is an idiomatic Shona expression, meaning sweep away the chaff. And I think calling it that would actually be to sanitize the wicked acts of murder, the wicked acts of violence that actually took place in Matabeleland, stretching from 1983 to 1987. So it is massacres, right? Remember a bloody violent season from late 1988, 1990, following Edgar Tekere's formation of Zimbabwe unit movement, ZUM. Remember the economic structural adjustment program is up in the late 1990s that actually left many poor. Remember the land seizures with atrocities associated with them. But also remember the two decades of state-sponsored killings, abductions, maimings, destruction of homes and people's lives livelihoods since the formation of the MDC in 1999. Ladies and gentlemen, the cycle within which we are currently under the so-called new dispensation is characterized by continued protection of the corrupt. We've never had a successful prosecution of corruption in this country, you know, except perhaps one or two people who would have fallen out of the ruling elite, right? It's also characterized by deceitfulness of the highest order, continued abductions, arbitrary arrests, selective application of the law, and reversal of the gains of the democratic struggle through unreasonable recalls of parliamentarians and councillors under the guise of the law, right? Now, resulting from this have been hurts, mistrust, a very, very divided nation, glaring absence of commonly shared values, and a national unifying vision among many such ills. So the nation, there's no nation really to talk about, because our leadership has failed to rally the people together. And we're saying that this independence has caused more division than ever before. Now, the church's position going forward, the church's position is that going forward, we can only return to normalcy if we embrace the truth. The Bible says that in John chapter number 8, verse 32, you will know the truth and the truth shall set you free. There is no amount, ladies and gentlemen, of gimmicks, no amount of propaganda that can ever replace the truth. Now, knowing this, fully aware of this statement, the psalmist puts forward in chapter number 85, verse 10, four personified concepts as central to the healing of any nation. And I want you to take note of this, because I believe very strongly that this is where our restoration comes from. This is where our healing will take place. Psalms number 85, verse 10, the psalmist writes, truth and mercy have met together. Justice and peace have kissed each other. Take note of those personified concepts. Take note of those images. A careful examination of the syntax, you know, the word order, you know, the careful examination of the syntax, you know, presented by this amazing poet shows the following. First, truth-telling is the starting point. In other words, what is it that has actually happened in our country? Who has killed who? I mean, who was behind the massacres in Matabeleland? Who coordinated the massacres? This is very, very important. Professor Gatsheni has talked a great deal about nationhood. The question is, what is the true foundation of nationhood? So truth is key in any nation build. We will be set free when we know the truth. Second, truth alone will not work. Now, after truth is told and confession is made, mercy ensues. When there is mercy, there is forgiveness. But he said, you cannot talk about forgiveness. You cannot talk about the fact that we need to forgive each other. Who has to be forgiven? Who wants to be forgiven? What has he done to whom? To whom? When have they committed these atrocities? So for there to be forgiveness, there has to be truth-telling. There has to be confession. Third, justice. And we're not just talking here about retributive justice, but restorative. This will move the nation forward. Now, selective application of the law is not justice. It should go. Now, you cannot have some people arrested, you know, for minor, you know, offenses, and others, you know, wallowing in prison. You know, people wallowing in prison, but somebody have committed real major, you know, crimes are actually roaming free. Number four, when justice happens, peace will be a natural outflow. Peace will kiss justice. So take note of those four personified concepts: truth, mercy, justice, and peace. Now, in conclusion, I just want to make reference to a peace-building scholar by the name of Ledrick. He talks about reconciliation as having three paradoxes that it has to deal with. He says, number one, reconciliation promotes an encounter between the opening of an expression of a painful past on the one hand, and the search for the articulation of a long-term interdependent future on the other. In other words, two things here. The fact that people need to be allowed to openly talk about their past hurts and pains, and having been healed, we also open up for an interdependent future. So a balance of those two. Number two, Ledrick says reconciliation provides a place for truth and mercy to meet. Truth and mercy to meet where concerns for exposing what has happened and for letting go in favor of renewed relationships are validated and embraced. So again, talking about what has happened, but also renewed relationships. This is truth and mercy. And then third, reconciliation should give time and space for both justice and peace. Ladies and gentlemen, as we reflect on 41 years of our independence, I believe very strongly that these very important four principles should be reflected on, and the new dispensation should come to terms with truth. I thank you.
Thank you, Bishop Magaya, for that illuminating presentation. I think we need to have a conversation around it. The presentation that has been made from the keynote at presentation by Professor Gatsheni and Tamuka and Bishop Magaya on Zimbabwe. Bishop Magaya clearly highlights the issues around the truth, the foundation upon which a nation should be built. Truth and mercy together, and justice and peace have keys. So Bishop Magaya really illuminates the issues around us. Justice, how do we move forward in a culture and a history of violence and segregation? So we call upon, thank you, Bishop Magaya, and you emphasize that truth alone is not enough, that there's need for mercy. But when justice happens,
We can't have peace without justice. Thank you, Bishop Magaya, for your presentation. I am trying to summarize it. But let's have a plenary on the presentation that has been made by our keynote speaker. We're going to have this for the next 5 minutes, and then we have other presentations that are going to come on as we go forward. Thank you, comrades. Thank you, Bishop Magaya. Thank you, Professor Gatsheni, and thank you, Tamuka. Let's have questions. Do we have questions that are coming from our comrades in the gallery? Issues, presentations, inputs. Zimbabwe at 41. So you raise your hand, I pick you, or you can, yeah, just raise your hand, I'll be able to see you. Thank you, comrades. Let's have these conversations. Are there questions in the gallery? Further elaborations to the presentation that have been made? Questions for clarifications? I'm trying to find, I've not yet found any name that has been raised. The mayor seems to have his hand raised. He doesn't know where to raise his hand, but it's okay. Being the mayor, we give you the privilege. Thank you, mayor. Can you come in?
Thank you very much. Loud and clear?
Very clear, mayor.
Thank you very much. First thing, do ZANU-PF leaders ever attend any of these sessions? Because I think they need to be listening and sharing. Secondly, our 41 years, first let me thank Professor Gatsheni and everyone who's contributed before me for their contributions to this very important matter. We've had 40 years of missed opportunities, and I think our worst enemies have been partisan politics and elections. I think those two.
Minister Alice Simba.
Hello. Can you mute that one so that the mayor can proceed? Thank you.
Hello.
Mayor, you can proceed.
Yes, I'm saying we've had twin enemies in elections and partisan politics. I think those two in particular have stolen a lot of our 41 years. So we've had missed opportunities that have taken away the opportunity for national, for oneness. We have had examples, and I relate well to two of them. The GNU was a period of relative oneness because we had a government of national unity. I also, from my own stations of service, I relate very well to the city of Harare in a manner that has hardly been reported. Besides all the toxicity with ministers and everything, the relationship among councillors was very good. We never had partisan fights. I had so many fights as mayor, but I'll tell you, in my entire 5 years, I never had a single fight with ZANU-PF councillors, the 10 of them. Those are simple examples that we can relate to in terms of attempting nationhood. I also chaired the leadership of mayors, which is the Urban Council Association of Zimbabwe. To this day, we are friends. We're chatting every day. It's another small example of nation, in addition to the GNU, which is the big one. I'm also saying, with a certain level of embarrassment, that it's been proven, whether we want to admit it publicly or not, that 90% of our leaders are in it and have been in it for the last 41 years for personal interests. And I'm saying with a certain level of embarrassment that actually there is an opportunity to use the personal interests of the leaders of the main political parties to secure nationhood, just like the GNU did. I think if we adopted a position where the leaders of the opposing factions, opposing forces in the country are accommodated with some level of respect, some level of personal interest, whether it's cars or titles or benefits, we may close the gap between the political toxicity at top levels. So I think dealing with the personal interests of our politicians may help us, the rest of us who are not in political leadership, find space to build nationhood and recover some of the time and opportunities that we have lost in the last 41 years. I also plead, because I think one of the questions that's been coming up is, where do we go from here? I have been saying for the last 4 years that we need 10 years of non-partisan elections, where the citizens of this country vote in individuals, in their individual capacity, no party candidates in any of the next two general elections. In those 10 years, I think we will allow the country to unite, to heal, and to rediscover the national agenda. I've already responded in a text to the remarks by Prof about our patriotism. I beg to differ on the level of patriotism that he ascribes to Zimbabwe. I think we're way short of minimum levels of patriotism. We need to revisit what it takes to be a Zimbabwean. We are short on civics, we are short on political alertness and contribution and commitment. We don't know our national anthem, we don't follow our constitution, we don't follow our laws. I think we've got a lot of deficit to deal with at individual levels. So those are sort of my sort of remarks inspired by the submission by Prof and also by the contributions by earlier speakers. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mayor. Because you're the mayor, we give you more time out of respect of your office. And thank you for the views that you raise and the questions that you raise to the professor and to other comrades that are in the platform. I think everyone has taken note of the issues that you raise. And of course, you want 10 years of elections without political parties. That's what you raise. And you say the challenges come from the political parties. Elections are a problem, so you say, and that our leaders are in the majority of them for the personal and less for the national. And so let's have the conversation. What is the national? What is the personal? And where are the citizens in this conversation? So we, any input from other comrades, colleagues in the gallery to input in this conversation. We are celebrating 41 years of independence for Zimbabwe. We are proudly Zimbabweans, and we are saying we need to take to introspect.
Hi, Rashid.
Yes, I was saying you can come in.
Yes, thank you. You know, I had an interesting conversation with some NASC students. They are on their fourth and fifth year, and they told me that just this morning, and they told me that when they first came here to Bulawayo, they were so surprised why the other Ndebele students were so angry at them. In fact, almost all of them, there are about 10 of them, they said they had not heard about Kukuraundi. It was their first time. You know, when they then further engaged, they then realized there's something that is making these people angry. So I think sometimes when we discuss on nation building, reconstruction of our country, build a new foundation, we want to look for fruits that are very far. Like, I think like what Professor Gatsheni said, let's start with low-hanging fruits. For instance, all of us who are here, who can speak the two main languages, Ndebele or Shona? Are you able to speak Ndebele? Have you made an effort to learn it? Have I made an effort to learn Shona? Can I speak it? To me, those are basics. Because these 10 guys I was talking to, they could not speak a single word in Ndebele. But the last 5 years, they've spent it here in Bulawayo. Because they say to me openly, they don't see the need. They'll not work here anyway. They'll go and work back in Harare. And they didn't see the problem. They could not see the problem. So the second issue I want to raise is maybe we need to go a little bit lower. Civic society groups that are here, when we do our civic education, are we getting to these young people, to these youth, to the younger generation, and begin to talk to them about different cultures, different languages? Why am I saying this? It's because at the core of Kukuraundi was the issue of ethnicity, the difference in languages. That's how Kukuraundi was projected. Of course, it had other political issues, but to the ordinary person, it was projected that I'm killing you because you are Ndebele. So could we go to the basics? Our constitution is addressing that. It is recognizing all the other languages. Why can't we learn them? Why can't we speak them? So I think in order to address the national question and problems, maybe there are some things we can do ourselves that do not need money, that do not need government, but can be done by us, can be initiated by us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Pastor Hussein. Thank you for raising these issues of what can we do at the personal level? What can we do to
deal with issues of tribalism, to deal with issues of Ukrawundi. How do we bring the various tribes together? What is the role and relevance of the tribe in our efforts? The role of language and culture in bringing people together. Thank you for that contribution. I think everyone has taken notes, and Professor Gatsheni has taken notes. I see a hand that is raised. I'm trying to see who it is, so that I can defer. So Jama, you can come in, so that we then can ask the presenters to come in and have some responses.
So Jama, thank okay. you. All right. Thank you. Thank you very much for affording me the opportunity. My question is directed particularly because I've seen that there are quite a number of scholars, particularly the renowned Sabelo Ndlovu Gatsheni. My question is, what has been the role for the past 40 years? What has been the role of scholars in creating this ideology that is so prevalent in Zimbabwe, and that is, for lack of a better word, I'll refer to it as Zanuism. We see this kind of ideology even in opposition parties, the way that they conduct themselves, the violence within the opposition parties, the way they even rig within their own electoral system. What has been the role of scholars in cultivating this ideology, and what can be the role of scholars in undoing this Zanuism? Because even if we talk about removing Zanu from power, the same kind of ideology is still prevalent among our people, whether it's the opposition or the general public. Those are my questions. Those are my two questions.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, comrade. I think let's give an opportunity to the presenters to respond to the questions that have been raised to them. I start with Professor Gatsheni. What has been the role of scholars in creating this ideology? So Jama calls it this Zanuism. And I think I'll give the comrades 5 minutes, all of them, to respond to these questions and other issues that have been raised, so that we go to the next presenters. Professor Gatsheni.
Thank you. Let me respond very quickly to this important question from, is it Sojama? Before he even posed it, I'd written something when I was listening to Reverend Hussein. I had written something about books and what the academics produce. Because if students who are at a university and they tell us that they've never heard about Kukurawundi, but they went through secondary school, primary school, high school, you wonder what they are learning. Because such a subject should be in the books in the first instance. If it is not in the books, therefore us as academics will fail to the nation as well. So it's an important question of how far do we go in speaking truth to power than becoming tools for propaganda? In my own career, when I began to talk about identities, a lot of people thought I was a tribalist by merely raising the questions. And I don't think we need to go back to those type of scholarship whereby we write what is comfortable for political regimes. We need to really be honest to truth. And that links to Bishop Magaya's presentation about truth and justice. And the epistemic justice is very important. As academics, we need to make sure that our contribution is really to bring truth and not to write what is convenient. That would be my response.
Thank you, Professor Gatsheni. Tamuga, anything that you noted from the points that have been raised that you might want to respond to, the clarifications and further elaborations?
I would say I think the prof has actually answered that, but there's also a question which Dr. Zams brought in as well around the issues of the issue of ideology, the justification of the violence on the basis of ideology, that it's actually dealing with it's a way of deconstructing neocolonialism. Certainly there's that kind of scholarship. And I think what this means, it also boils back to the issue to say, even civil society, to say as civil society, what are we doing in terms of building knowledge systems or scholarship that responds to some of this kind of ideology? Because even when you talk around the whole issue around Honde, Mida, or Jambanja, there's a justification to it. There's a justification to it on an ideological basis. So I hear what he's saying, but I think when we're looking, like when I was looking in terms of the prognosis, it's something which you didn't pay attention to, but also when reflecting on it, it also means that this is something which has been a point which has also been limited. And I think Miles Tendi's one point which he notes quite well in his book, in his works on intellectuals making history in Zimbabwe. So it's something which as civil society, we and as activists also need to invest in so that we're able to respond to this kind of scholarship, which advances certain notions, which are counter to what we seek to achieve. That's why all I can say for now. Thank you.
Hey, maybe I can come in also, Tamuka, to reinforce something.
Thank you, Prof. You can come in.
Yes, particularly Tamuka, the question raised by the question of Yeros and the same Moyo. Thank you for alerting me to that. I had written something down to respond to it, but I forgot. I think one of the areas where I've been working on for the past 10 years is the area of decolonizing knowledge. And in the area of decolonizing knowledge, there are some epistemic values which we've taken to be truth. An epistemic value like the will to power. Politics is all about will to power, is not about will to live. And the idea that nation building is always a violent process. And all that, I think we need to rethink it because it comes from a particular history and more so a history not which is not African. It is actually part of Western political theory about will to power, about a war being another extension of politics by other means. And all that, they were justifying issues of colonialism when they were using all those, and they are making them dictates today to us that politics, war, don't distance politics and war. They are together. And I think it is a moment in the present conjuncture that we begin to rethink those ideas. Western theories have written volumes justifying that war is natural. But why do you write a book to justify something which is natural? It means it's not natural. You are actually making it, naturalizing it. And you can see some of the theorizing about Africa actually are drawing from that type of scholarship and justifying some of the most notorious behaviors of the state. Thank you.
For that illuminating the clarity on. Thank you very much. And if I don't seem to be seeing any questions being raised, I call upon Takuzwa from the Zenasu and students. And you only have 4 minutes. You're not here, Comrade President. So we're asking you to take about 4 minutes at most to give the student perspective so that we can have the conversation going on. Takuzwa in? If Takuzwa is not in, Gosi, can you please come in from the youth perspective? Gosi, from Kweke Ngosilati.
Thank you very much, Comrade Mahia. I would like to thank all the presenters for steering such an illuminating discussion. I want to take less than 4 minutes because I want to understand. I want to believe people have been listening for some time now, so I do not exhaust our beloved and patriotic audience. As we reflect and celebrate 41 years of independence, what I can say is everything that can go wrong in Zimbabwe has gone wrong. The regime has done all it can to destroy, rape, and plunder the republic. It's an insult to expect us young people to go to celebrate the Independence Day at a time one of us, a young person like us, Makomborero Haruziwise, is serving 1 year, 2 months for exercising his constitutional rights. Tatenda Mumbeyarara had his bones broken. He was tortured for exercising his rights. Tawanda Mche, you were abducted. Joanna Mamombe, Cecilia, the angel. So as young people, we find nothing to celebrate at all under such a fascist regime, which does not respect the voice of young people. So going back to the issue of nation building, it is very difficult and impossible to build any nation, especially under such a criminal government like the one we have. You can't create a nation under such a, if I can borrow Professor George B.N. Aitese, under such a barbarous coconut head. It's very difficult to build any nation. We need to go back to the roots of where this problem is coming from. Allow me to debunk the spirit of the liberation struggle, politics of entitlement and patronage, the Chinuchedu syndrome. Just because they went to the liberation struggle before we were born, they think they own us. They think they own the country. We appreciate their role, but it's in fighting against colonialism. But it is wrong. We are all Zimbabweans. This country belongs to us. So it's very difficult to create or build any nation. Nation mentality, as young people who feel totally excluded and disenfranchised by such an attitude and mentality. Enough of lamenting, the way forward, as I conclude, youth inclusion is very, very important if you are to build any nation. 67.7% of the total population of this country are young people. By young people, I mean those under the age of 35. But we are totally excluded. Madara hadi nenyikai. Just because they went to the liberation struggle before we were born, they think we do not have the potential or the capacity to carry forward from where they left. After all, they've destroyed everything. There's also a need to respect constitutionalism, to build strong institutions. Some of the things have already been mentioned. So I will conclude by a quote from Nelson Mandela, which says, "The time comes in the life of any nation when there remain only two choices, submit or fight. I choose the latter." Young people have to non-violently fight to reclaim their space, because there's no nation building that can be done without us young people at the center of it. We have to fight to reclaim our space. We have to fight to dismantle fascism, which has ravaged this country for 41 years. May God save the Republic. I thank you.
Thank you, Comrade Gosi. Madara, hadi nenyika.
Hadi nacho chini.
That's what he says. Thank you, Comrade Gosi. How do we... There's a time when people have to either fight or submit. He says they have to fight. The young people are imprisoned, and he lists the number of young people, Akomborero, Joanna, young people for doing nothing. And they don't see any reason why they could be part of this, and they don't see value from the independence, because they are being subjected to the very same discrimination and repression that the Madaras faced during the liberation struggle. So he says, we cannot submit, we will fight. Takuza, from the students' movement, the president of ZANU, what are the academic freedoms? Are you excited? Are you happy with 41 years of independence? Takuza, can you please come in?
Definitely not, Comrade Chairperson. Revolutionary ethos to all the participants who are part of this meeting. It is my hope that I am quite audible enough to articulate the discourse in order to restore the legacy of Zimbabwe. It is quite clear that ZANU-PF is reneged on the values and ethos of the liberation struggle. What is the liberation struggle? That is the first question that we must be able to answer. But to us as the students, the liberation struggle is a reflection of how we should be able to express ourselves within the vision of the Zimbabwe National Students Union to create an inclusive and democratic Zimbabwe with students as integral stakeholders, where student concerns are heard and academic freedoms are upheld and promoted. It is quite clear that the regime of Emmerson Mnangagwa has shown clearly that it is there to thwart the democratic space and also to make sure that the civic society space will be shrinking from dusk to dawn. We have noted from 2020 the escalation of arrests, particularly of student leaders, myself to mention, the vice president to mention others. We had around 40 and above students being arrested in Zimbabwe. It is a reflection of how we are living in a nation as victims of first-degree misgovernance under one Emmerson Damson Mnangagwa. Thus, I shall not waste my time to articulate the grievances which have been articulated before. My focus as a revolutionary intellectual is to articulate the solutions towards governing this country. The solutions are anchored upon the five pillars which we suggest as the student movement. Number one, what we need for Zimbabwe to change and transform towards the social and egalitarian society is truth, reconciliation, and forgiveness, TRF. What do we mean by such? We mean that the wounds of Kukura Wound should be addressed. Emmerson Damson Mnangagwa should make sure that they compensate victims, they tell the truth that they killed people in Matabeleland. They should be there to tell people that during the times of Mrambatrina, they destroyed houses of people who were living, they destroyed livelihoods during that time. It, the foundation of truth should be built. Then people will reconcile. Then after that, we have forgiveness. That is an attempt and a message that was being sent by organizations such as the Zimbabwe Council of Churches when they were trying to implement the national dialogue. Organizations such as Crisis Zimbabwe Coalition, to which myself, I am the chairperson of the youth committee. We're trying to make sure that there be talks between Emmerson Damson Mnangagwa and of course the movement of democratic change. Number two, social and economic reform. By social and economic reform, we are clear as the students of Zimbabwe that our lives are there deteriorating from dusk to dawn. We are living below the poverty timeline. So at the end of the day, you tend to see that, of course, fees increases and fees hikes are a norm of the day. Every semester, we are receiving a package from the Ministry of Higher and Tertiary Education, Innovation and Development under one Professor Muruira, increasing fees. But that's not alone. You tend to realize that their focus is on increasing fees, but they forget that students are no objects at all. They are human beings who also require food to survive. So when we say they require food to survive, we are speaking issues in regards to social justice, in which students are need to consume the basic desires of their life. They need to travel, and we are already seeing that there is a transport challenge at the end of the day. Theirs is a solution is to introduce ZUPCO buses in which people are already queuing up, which is already contradicting with the COVID-19 World Health Organization regulations which were stipulated. So we are already seeing that there is mayhem within the heads of the autocratic regime and the dictatorship of one Emmerson Damson Mnangagwa. A solution number three, of course, I go on to mention CAC, which is Citizen Action Against Corruption. Corruption has since affected the education sector, because you tend to see that the 15 billion, of course, is a question that has not been answered up until now. But there are funds which are being misplaced. Corruption inhibits economic development. It buttresses social inequalities. It is there to make sure that the government does not function well. So at the end of the day, issues towards the anti-corruption commission being independent should be addressed, so that monies which are being spent, illicit financial flows, which are going day by day, which we do not even see, should make sure that they fund the education sector. Because at the end of the day, students should not be paying for education. The government should be the parent of each and every student in this nation. A solution number four, I tend to articulate, of course, HICFA, healthcare for all. We tend to note that the last year, the nurses and doctors were in a spree of demonstrating against their salaries, which of course are peanuts at all. So we as a students movement believe that we are number one. We have the probity to question such because we are sons and daughters of those who are part of the health sector, number one. Number two, as human beings, we also deserve to have a good health, and we also deserve to have a functional health system.
That's it. Yes, thank you.
That's at the end of the day, solution number four, ICFA, healthcare for all. We are speaking as the students' movement that they should make sure that our parents and guardians who are part of the health sector are paid enough. Number two, us as human beings deserve a functional health system. Number five, it takes to educate. This comes, of course, after we as the students' movement have analyzed the budgetary analysis which was given by one primary school and Sunday school dropout, Ntulinguwe, articulating that Zimbabwe's income is coming much from tax. And we are saying tax should be there to provide for revenue, but revenue should be there to provide for education. So at the end of the day, that tax should make sure that it subsidizes the education sector. We need, as the students, to have a minimum budgetary allocation from one trillion with his Minister of Finance and Economic Development, giving a sum to the education sector. What they are offering is not enough. What they are offering for the military is, of course, maybe thrice the amount. But are we at risk? That's the question. We need to develop further as a nation. We need to make sure that we believe in education. And in my submissions as the president of the Zimbabwe National and yet International Students Union, I do submit that the ability to learn is a gift. The capacity to learn is just but the capacity to learn. It's just part of you, but we make sure that is the Zimbabwe National Students Union, we shall fight to the ends. That's why you have seen that we have been fighting for two things, particularly social justice and academic freedom to prevail. And people have been questioning our morality and probity to partake into the national discourse. But this has happened during the 1998 struggles, 2000 struggles, when Lenmo Juda Chong, who is the first president of the Zimbabwe National Students Union, was there to challenge the one-party state under one Robert Gabriel Mugabe. But right now, it's a change of the system. We now have a black oppressor. Then they were fighting for against the white oppressor. It's just but painful that we just have a change of skin, but the oppressor remains the oppressor. So as the Zimbabwe National Students Union, we do hereby submit that it's time that Emmerson Mnangagwa Mnangagwa chooses to shape up or ship out. As the Zimbabwe National Students Union, we do hereby submit that it's time that Emmerson Mnangagwa recognizes the five pillars that we have mentioned in terms of restoring the legacy of this nation, in order for us to please not only the dead who fought during the liberation struggle, but the yet to be born who do not know that such dictators who participate in the kakistocracy do not know that they exist. They don't even know they yet to be born. And of course, for the present, those who are living, for them to have a well standard of living in which there is efficiency, effectiveness of the government, in which there is a social contract between the governed and the governors. It is what we are fighting for. Students also attain that freedom. And in my submissions, I have articulated the grievances as anyone else would do. But as the student leader and as a students' movement, we have articulated the solutions along which the five pillars that I have articulated will shape up this country to be a first world and developed country, not a developing country like it is. And if not, of course, we can question the probity of it being a developing country anyway. So I have articulated these solutions. And in conclusion, I do hereby state that a student's movement without an intellectual base is just but a criminal organization, if not a terrorist organization. So thus, I do hereby submit as the president of SINASU that we should follow the prescribed solutions in order to restore the legacy of this country. We are independent, but we are not free. Thank you very much, Comrade Chairperson.
Thank you, Comrade President, and thank you. It's very clear you provide solutions. We are independent, but we are not free. And you provide the five pillars that are solutions to the current challenges that we face. And thank you for raising those as part of the conversation that we're having. Professor Gatsheni seems to wants to leave now. Can we have your parting shots, Professor Gatsheni, if you're still here, as you go, and then we can wrap up the meeting. Okay, it seems like Professor Gatsheni, Professor Gatsheni, are you here? Also, Professor Gatsheni is gone. So we're also beyond our time. We've gone beyond our time. This is an exciting, exhilarating conversation. So there are comrades that were not here that might not find time to have this conversation with us. Are there comrades that are here that were supposed to make a presentation? They gave us 2 minutes because we are beyond our time. You understand these things around the presence. The WICO's representative, women's coalition representative, I know the gender balance, it has to be, it does not be seen to be done, but to be done. Can you come in, please? And then we wrap up for the day.
Thank you very much. Congrats. Blessed afternoon to everybody. Nomuhle Nyoni, reporting on behalf of Women's Coalition of Zimbabwe, WICOS.
Nomuhle, we can't hear you. Are you still there?
On the positives, being a signatory to the, I have admitted.
Yeah, we can hear you now. We can hear you now.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you now. We can hear you loud and clear.
Thank you very much. I was saying, we're starting on the positives. Would like to applaud Zimbabwe as the Women's Coalition of Zimbabwe for being a signatory to the International Human Rights Frameworks for Women's Rights. Zimbabwe ratified the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, CEDAW, in 1991, which is considered as the Women's Bill of Rights. Under this convention, states have the obligation to review their legal systems in order to end discrimination and to establish institutions that protect women. As part of the obligations, CEDAW allows for the monitoring of compliance and receives complaints from the signatory state. However, Zimbabwe is not yet to the CEDAW's optional protocol of to receive and consider member states. Zimbabwe is also a signatory to the Beijing Declaration of 1995, the Protocol to the African Charter on Women's Rights of 2003, and the SADC Protocol on Gender and Development of 2008. Additionally, Zimbabwe's commitment towards the participation and empowerment of women has been explicitly expressed through the constitution-making process of 2013. The 2013 Constitution was created on the founding values and principles of fundamental human rights and freedoms and gender equality, among many others. The current transformative Constitution provides better protection and visibility to women's rights than the previous Constitution. The specific provisions for the promotion, protection, and enforcement of women's rights in Zimbabwe include the following. Section 17 is dedicated to gender and urges the state to promote the full participation of women in all spheres on the basis of equality with men. This section addresses access to resources, elimination of gender-based discrimination in policy, law, and practice, the protection of women and girls from domestic violence, as well as protection of girls from marriage. Those are teenage marriages and early marriages. Section 80 focuses on the rights of women and highlights the provision for equal opportunities in political, social, and economic activities. It also grants women the same rights as men regarding custody and guardianship of children. Previously, the Guardianship of Minors Act was biased towards women, granting automatic custody rights to women, whilst men were restricted to guardianship and access rights. The section also provides that all customs, traditions, and cultural practices that infringe the rights of women are void. Women have been vulnerable to all sorts of harmful traditional practices, such as early child marriages, forced marriages, and genital mutilation. Section 85 buttresses the enforcement of fundamental human rights and freedoms by the courts and granting of appropriate relief and compensation where one's rights have been infringed. Section 78 of the Constitution is on marriage rights. It provides that every person who has attained the age of 18 has a right to found a family and that no person can be compelled to enter into a marriage against their will. Women have often been forced into marriage, and this section prohibits that. Section 71 on property rights means that women can also acquire, hold, occupy, use, lease, and dispose of all forms of property. Section 245 calls for the establishment of the Gender Commission, whose mandate is to ensure gender equality, investigate violations, and take action. Section 246 mandates the commission to conduct research into issues relating to gender and social justice and recommend changes to laws and practices which lead to discrimination based on gender. Due to the acknowledgement that women and girls are often victims of social and economic injustice.
Can we wrap up?
Okay, let me round up. It was imperative that the legal frameworks and policies be enacted to ensure their protection. These constitutional provisions have been promulgated in various subsidiary legislation, which include the Domestic Violence Act, which makes provision for the protection and relief of victims of domestic violence. We are mindful and thankful of the fact that Zimbabwe has established the Ministry of Women Affairs, Gender and Community Development in 2005, which is dedicated to elevating the status of women, youth, children, disadvantaged men, and other gender groups. We have negatives. There's gender-based violence. It's on the increase. 19, I'm just running through. Sorry. We have the marriages bill, which seeks to ban child marriages, which is a good move. However, there is need to expedite the process to ensure that we have an enforceable piece of legislation that speaks to the protection of the girl child. And we also have mothers' rights to children, we have women and the informal economy. Oh, I had a lot with women's participation in decision-making processes. We are thankful of that, although we feel, for instance, we really need Lady Vice President. Zimbabwe currently has no woman in the top three, with the only last female vice president having left office on 8 December 2014. In conclusion, I would say, Watintu Mfazi, Watintu Mbokoto. Thank you so much.
Thank you, comrade. The challenge of being the chair is you get various messages in your inbox from comrades. So you might ever actually get confused in the process, but we've had a very wonderful meeting and conversation as the coalition, as we celebrate 41 years of independence. There are so many issues that we want to discuss. 41 years is a long time, so there are many issues, many contradictions that come, many issues of celebrations that are there. So we might not take as much as we want. We are also new to this idea of social media. We are from the traditional media, and but I can just summarize what I get from this conversation, that 41 years of independence The young people are up and and uprising and angry and unhappy with the state. The many of them are in prisons and jails. Just the same that applied to the liberation war fighters prior to 1918. Women remain vulnerable, even though we've got a new constitution. The state, the nation is polarized on the basis of political party affiliation and gender. Patriotism has to be legislated for it to be implemented. Elections are a source of fear and conflict and polarizing, and they're not about delivery of services and delivery of political goods, but about which political party you belong to. I work in rural communities. People access social services on the basis of the political party card that they carry or the t-shirt that they wear on the for them to get the services, especially even on food aid to the vulnerable communities. And we are celebrating 41 years of independence. We have a patriotic bill that is coming into effect or that is being negotiated. We had a 2013 constitution that was negotiated with so many rights to the citizens, but that is being eaten into through the amendment of the constitution. There's so much that's happening in Zimbabwe. And when we have this conversation about Zimbabwe at 41, we can't exhaust all. We can't end the conversation today. We have to have this conversation going on and on, because the issues that we raise are about livelihoods, about our nationhood, are also about the nation called Zimbabwe and the future of our children and the future of this teapot-shaped country. So I thank you, comrades, that have participated in this conversation. I'll leave this opportunity to the spokesperson of the Christ Love Coalition, Comrade Mr. Kumalo, to thank you all and close this meeting. Comrade Kumalo, it's up to you. Can you please take over? Thank you.
Thank you, Chairperson. Thank you so much. Firstly, I would like to apologize to our panelists and participants. We all know that this meeting was scheduled to end at 1 p.m., but due to its explosive nature, people were rearing to go. People had a lot of ideas to share. I ask for everyone's patience. Wasting much time in terms of at 41, Professor Sabelo Gatsheni Ndlovu discussion. Really, the keynote address was a moving presentation. He has framed civil society's work and narratives going forward. I think in terms of what we should do as civil society, what we should do as Zimbabweans, what we should youth, women, and so forth. He framed our work. It was articulate. It was a right stage at the right time. The coalition who captured the ideas of nation building, and we promise that to run with the
can we hear you, Spokes? Is it my network?
We have a next step and not a party-driven state, but we want a national political affiliation, religious affiliation, and so forth. Yes, I can hear you.
Thank you, Spokes. I think the network is bad. The network is bad, and I think it's because of the issues around access to information.
I can hear you. Am I being heard?
You are dragging.
Hello?
You are dragging, Comrade Spokes.
Hello? Comrade Maia.
Now you can speak here.
Thank you all for the lively participation, and we are looking.
Thank you, spokesperson. His network is not that good. So thank you, comrades, for participating in this meeting. We thank you for your participation, for your input. The conversation around Zimbabwe can never come to an end.
Now, comrades,
yeah, you are taking comrades.
One series brought to us by thanking Professor Sabelo Ndlovu Gatsheni. I think in his presentation, he framed
Well, thank you, comrades. Unfortunately, the spokesperson's network is not that good, so we couldn't hear him as he closes the meeting. Thank you, comrades, for participating in this meeting. Thank you for the insightful conversations that we have. We are celebrating Zimbabwe at 41, and we understand that there are a number of celebrations, a number of achievements that we've made, but a lot of regrets, and the young people are not happy with what we have. The women are crying, and also all citizens. Zimbabwe is polarized. Let's find solutions to dealing with Zimbabwe's challenges. We need to come together as citizens to deal with the challenges that we face. And a takeaway from Professor Gatsheni, Zimbabwe did not exist before 1980. We need to work together to build Zimbabwe. And for us to build this country, we need to hold each other to account, hold the state to account, and make sure that the resources that are in the confines of this country called Zimbabwe, are used for the benefit of the most downtrodden to all citizens, benefit for us to build a truly transparent, a truly democratic society. From the Crisis Zimbabwe Coalition, we'll continue to provide you these platforms. We have conversations around building a society that is a democratic, a society that respects the rights of citizens and for the protection of the constitution that we put into being in 2013. From all of us from the Crisis Coalition, thank you for paying attention. Thank you for contributing. Thank you for your participation. Until we meet again, thank you. May God bless you. Thank you.